Hi, I'm Khushbu. I'm co-founder and CEO of Kaarva. Let's go back to where I come from, which is I belong to a very small village in Rajasthan. But my dad was in a transferable job, so I traveled all across India. So I've lived in a very small town, or to a small village, or tier one town, all across until I ended up at IIT Bombay, where I graduated in 2007. Worked with corporates in India when my career goal was to become like follow the path of Indra Nooyi. So entrepreneurship happened to me by coincidence. So on the path of Indra Nooyi's career, I went, joined Procter & Gamble. From there I went and did my MBA from Harvard Business School. And then because the things had changed back here around how India was evolving, plus my husband, he had jumped into the entrepreneurship. That brought me back to India, and when I moved back to India, I always wanted to do something which was for more of the mass India, the billion people of India, and that's where I started to carve out my path. Worked with InMobi for a little while, and then also bid Encore, which is an incubator for tech not-for-profit startups, just before Kaarva. And about a year back, we started to help do more financial inclusion for people who are in the low-medium income segments of India through Kaarva. We look at India mostly top-down, 1.2 billion people, but if you look India from bottom, right? So there are almost about 685 million people. We don't call them below poverty line, but they will be missing at least one essential element which is needed to fulfill your human potential, and that's 685 million people, more than 50% of India's population. And while there's a very strong ecosystem that had started into the for-profit space, like that has not happened in the not-for-profit space. In the not-for-profit space, image is still like a jholawala guy in kurta pajama running an anath ashram, but that's not the reality. The reality is that there are a large number of very talented people leaving behind opportunity cost and trying to do something good, and at the same time there are CSR funds, which is huge amount of funds, which are lying there, and those leaders of CSR don't know where to put it. You know, I think true for a large number of Indians, while I may have gone to HBS, and that sometimes comes to as a baggage, because most of the time people tend to think that, oh, okay, you went to, you know, Harvard, you must have been from a very well-to-do family or things like that, right? But that's not really true. Like, I had a very, very humble upbringing. And as I was saying, living with my dad, he, for the most part of his life, was in rural banking, and that means that there will be 80-90 branches in very rural parts of India where he will go and visit, and we will just like catch on his vehicle to go and see sometimes interiors of the India. To a large part, actually, I feel that I have transcended from those small town, from that small town girl to like a big city, or even gone outside India. But I think core inside me, I'm still that. Most of my friends who went to school with me still live there, and there's a very different life than the life which is of mine. And I think very few people get this opportunity to first to even try entrepreneurship. So between me and my husband, both of us are fairly well-to-do career-wise. So we can live with one paycheck, honestly, right? I mean, so we said that, okay, one person will earn the paycheck, another person will do whatever they want to do. And when you deep down think what you really want to do, it's not to earn just more money to live a better lifestyle. I already have a better lifestyle than I ever imagined I ever had. But I think that's not true for a large number of the friends that I had growing up or where I come from. So I do feel that if I have the opportunity to do this, which very few people in this life get, do something which is meaningful. So that's where that passion comes from. I think consumer media technology has always been my forte. Like, I'm a very consumer-centered person. So that's always excites me, and my consulting experiences were also around that, working with some very, very large clients, global CPG companies, global education companies, and all headquartered in US. When you walk out of a headquarter, I think it's completely different. You're actually kind of driving the real decisions that actually happen on the ground. So yeah, that was very interesting. a very high level, Kaarva for us is a notion that everybody who is a working class should have easy access, easy way to make their finances work. When you actually do not earn a large amount of money, most of your life revolves around the cash flow that you have, because you need that cash flow to put food on the table for your family. You need that cash flow to give, you know, to get your kids to a better school so that they have a better life. So that's what really, for most of the Indians, like 90% of the Indians, money is all about, right? But access to it has always been, like, you can think of, it's been always very difficult. You can think of, there are so many villains in this whole story, right? If you are not earning much, the system is against you, right? I mean, banks will charge you minimum balance penalty because I can't keep 3,000 rupees in my bank account. If I delay my Airtel bill by 2 days, I will be charged 100 rupees on a 400 rupee bill while I didn't get my salary. Why? Because that promoter for whom I work didn't sign the check. He didn't have the time to sign the check. These are things which are not in control for most of us, but we get penalized for it. So for us, Kaarva overall is an idea where all of us are in together to fight these inequalities and have better access to our own cash flow so that we can run our life much better. And not only have access to when we need the money, but to save, to grow financially over time. We have started with a very small product, which we believe is everybody's right, which is that why when I'm working today, I get to get my salary, which is my hard-earned money, after 30 days. Who made that 30-day arbitrary rule? If I need the money that I need, which I have earned, I should have access to it as and when I want. So we want to put that control of our own salary in hands of the people whose salary it is, right? I should have the control when I withdraw, when I not withdraw. If I don't want to withdraw before 30 days, great. But if I want to, I should have that control. So that's what Kaarva is. Essentially, Kaarva gives people a control over accessing their own earned wages. We are city agnostic. We operate all across India. 50% of our customers come from tier 2, tier 3, tier 4 towns. In terms of number of companies, we have customers from now more than 1,000 different companies accessing Kaarva. So once you land, once you get to know about Kaarva, you can reach out to us mainly two ways. One, you land on our website and from there you go to our web app, or from there you get redirected to our WhatsApp number. For us, WhatsApp is an end-to-end transactional thing for a customer. So we want our customers to do everything on WhatsApp ideally, but of course in some cases when a customer wants a richer experience, we can't offer that on WhatsApp. So that's the time when we redirect them to our web app. And given the onboarding process is a little involved, it's not like I just gave my phone number and OTP and boom, you are done. Large number of our customers want to talk to someone. There are two important levers that we have. One, we are actually working with people who are low and medium income segments. Or, let me put it differently, they are the masses of India, the next billion people, right? To them, the first point of access for anything is actually not a Play Store. It's WhatsApp, which is already there, installed on their phone when they bought the phone, right? So most of these people who are now coming on board are not talking to their native language. They will be accessing anything and everything. Like the two things that they actually use is probably WhatsApp and YouTube, the most often or not, apart from some of the other local, regional channel stuff, right? So WhatsApp becomes very, very important for us to actually reach to those people where they are, right? That's where our members are. Second is, as I said, it is access to their own pages. So in Kaarva, what we have is a very interesting behavioral experiment, which is we don't charge any interest or processing fee. We'll let our users decide how much they want to pay for our service, like a tip. And why that is, again, because we believe that it is their right to have access to their own earned wages. Now, when you look at this, how our customer is finding us, we have two channels to get to our users. To achieve this mission, right? One is we go and tie up with companies who will be willing to have their employees have this access whenever they want. In that case, an internal communication happens with the users, and then they can actually just reach out to us on our WhatsApp number. There is no app to download, there is no web app to go to. Directly reach out to us on our WhatsApp channel. In the B2C world, where we actually directly go to the user, because we believe that the market is very large and we won't be able to reach as fast to every employer to enable this, we let employees take that decision for themselves. They can reach out to us. That happens mainly through two channels, right? One is through our social media advertising, right? So then they can land to our website, from which they are redirected to either a web app, where they can just say, okay, I allow Kaarva to reach out to me on WhatsApp, and then the communication on WhatsApp starts. Or there is a large number of people who come through referral, and referral is directly from WhatsApp to WhatsApp. So one of our WhatsApp customers will actually share about us on one of the WhatsApp groups, and the person then just clicks and lands on our WhatsApp channel. So that's how most of the people find out about us. So yes, when a user has a query, they will ping us on WhatsApp. Now there are two ways it can get handled. One, it could be an auto recipe where we try and direct our user, but we are fairly early and there are new and new questions which keep coming in every day. So if it is not answered automatically by the bot, we actually use our advisors, who will then handle those questions on a real-time basis. Most often or not, they are still. So the challenge that you see is that the articulation of the question may be many different ways, while the answers are similar. So we do go and do a lot of quick responses. So it's not that our agents have to type a lot, but still, quick responses work once you understand the query better. And every day we are actually trying to understand how can we answer those questions in a more automated fashion. One, our user is just, or everybody, all of us are just hooked onto WhatsApp. There is no way we are going to get deleted, right? Also, we check WhatsApp probably 10 times in a day, right? So if there is a notification on WhatsApp, the likelihood of you checking that versus a notification on 100 different apps you may have on your phone, the likelihood on WhatsApp is almost 10x or 100x more. I don't know, but it is significantly more, right? That is one reason. Second, we want it to be as easy for the user, right? And while when the user is already used to typing, chatting on WhatsApp, it is very, very natural for them to revert back on it. Combine that with the technology which WhatsApp has already built. So WhatsApp works phenomenally well even in 2G networks, even in 3G networks. Documents or customers required to share some documents for verification, right? Sharing those documents, if they do it on WhatsApp on a low internet, the likelihood of that being successful is much, much higher than the likelihood of that being successful on our app, because we will have to kind of build all the technology which WhatsApp has already built, right? So again, that's the benefit of it being much, much more reliable in those settings. And lastly, we are in the end a finance product. Communication and experience is one of the most important things. Now imagine if I send a communication on email or on message versus I send it on WhatsApp. My linkage is much, much more stronger when it is on WhatsApp. So because of these three reasons, one, user already has it, is used to using it. It is far more reliable for our customer segment. And third, it is real-time communication, right? I think that itself end-to-end is phenomenal, and that's why we are so gung-ho about building all of this on WhatsApp rather than our own third platforms. The way we look at it is that probably the acquisition is much, much faster and the word of mouth is much, much faster when you are actually on WhatsApp. Why? Because in the end, sharing is gonna happen on WhatsApp. The customers that we are trying to serve, one, do they even have a Play Store is a question mark. Do they know how to use a Play Store is second. Third, when a user clicks on something, when it is a web link or a WhatsApp, it's real time. If I actually have to download an app, it will take good 30 seconds, 1 minute or so. It may fail internet connectivity and all of that. So from an onboarding perspective, for getting a customer to convert, WhatsApp is far faster than an app, in my opinion. from day zero, we were very clear that we wanted to build this end-to-end experience for a user on WhatsApp. And that's how we began. But we had no access to APIs, so we said we'll start using business accounts. And this was all experimentation, right? Does this work? What are the benefits of it? So we actually used business accounts. Everything was fairly manual. We will revert back manually. The customer will revert back manually, you know, all of that. And there is also a limitation of how many number of people we can actually chat on a business account with WhatsApp. So as we started to grow and we got the conviction what product that needs to be built and is actually the right product for the customer segment that we are talking about, we started to move in the direction of saying now we need access to business APIs. In fact, before we had business APIs, we had three different WhatsApp numbers which we were working through because we were scaling and one number was not good enough. So we will work on a phone and we will connect that phone also to the web app so the six people can actually chat to the customers and all like hacky stuff. And then when we moved to, so we wanted to have WhatsApp business APIs. We got our WhatsApp business APIs. Now most of the business APIs, either you build your own logic, which is a chat based bot, but given we also have the complexity of Indian audience reverting back in Indian languages, you cannot have like a sophisticated bot answer all of that. So you have a fair bit of queries that needs to be handled through agents manually. And for us, that's where actually Verloop came in. Very interestingly, we were able to plug in Verloop and the WhatsApp APIs and then enable a large number of our advisors to handle all of those queries, even on WhatsApp. So one is anyways the scale, right? You cannot scale beyond a certain stage. Second, you can't automate. Like you can only automate the good night message and the good morning message, right? You cannot, like if a user says, where do we want to achieve, right? You are a user, you are a repeat user of Kaarva. In the evening at 8 o'clock, you have run out of petrol in your bike and your salary is yet 2 days away. We used to get a message saying, I need 500 rupee cash out from my account. We want that message to go to our backend and automatically a money transfer trigger happening where the money is coming to his account real time. This is just impossible on WhatsApp business because you just can't integrate, right? So growth is anyways a problem, but the second, your automation, the real-time experience that you want to give, you can't give that. So that is all possible only if you have business API. Once we got our APIs, we were in the zone saying, okay, now I need the bot facility as well as the agent chat facility, because without that, we can't build this from the get-go. And that was the time when I got introduced to Verloop. Once we got in touch with Verloop, I understood this was a product which will serve the need that we have, which is both. Actually three needs, right? Three needs are, one, agent can revert back when there is a manual query. A bot can revert back smartly based on the pre-fed. And the third one, which we are actually working through right now, is that real time, all of this info is also coming to our backend, right? And this is all together, right? You cannot have the query coming to our backend in silo and the agent sitting in silo. It has all to be all together because you don't know which answer has to go to which path. So that's why we decided that, you know, Verloop will be an interesting play for us. We wanted to start with the manual flow and then automate. That's how we were going about it. Once we got onboarded with Verloop, I think the great campaign managers actually at Verloop who take care of it. We just need to send our templates and then they will help us set up, you know, what is the flow that we want. So it's been very fairly fast. Like, I mean, within a day, once we get our template approved, we can set up a flow, and the system is also so intuitive that we can also do it ourselves. For us, location, document sharing were critical, and getting to know, getting that files on the backend was very important. I think as we discussed this, our engineering team at Verloop prioritized a lot of those for us, and now in 3 months, I think it's a full-fledged system that we needed. Of course, there are more improvements that we keep asking on a daily basis. We realize, okay, we need this also and that also. But I think they've been very fairly fast in implementing all of that. So I think Verloop is working good for us because we've been able to grow almost 10x. Number of queries that we've been able to respond back to also has increased. I would say that we have been able to do this growth on WhatsApp because we need a support system like Verloop. Let's define everything as a stage. A user goes from stage A, B, C, D, let's say up to 10 steps he has to do. So right from he signing up to he provide. Most of our users, when they sign up, they are actually signing up with an intent. So they will actually provide the necessary documents that we need. Now at that moment, maybe they are actually facing some issue, right? And that time a communication begins with us saying, you know, I need some help, or this is the issue that I'm having. We are able to resolve that at that time and then redirect them back on the journey, on the customer journey. Now let's say the customer has finished half of the profile and not the other half, and the other half we approve, like yes, this customer has passed that, then we can again re-engage the user to say, you know, this much is done, can you just finish this much? If he finishes everything, after that also there is a bank setup which is needed. Let's say something goes wrong in the bank setup, then again the customer comes back and then we help them through the bank setup. So there are like basically stages, and every stage we kind of figure out where the customer drops off and then how do we help them more so to revert back. What is interesting in our case is that our business case is also of a very high urgency, and that's why WhatsApp works even better in that case, because if I don't revert, like I think 24 hours is too long a period to revert to any customer's query. The moment we get within 5, 10, 15 minutes, if we do not revert back, we have lost them as a member. We have also their own use case, right? So WhatsApp, on WhatsApp, we do all of these. The moment something happens, we kind of get them in. It's a 24 hours window anyways for us to revert back. So most often or not, the moment we revert back, the customer is now following through the journey. If he gets some issue, he can revert back to us and then a response goes to get him on board. If the customer is completely done the onboarding after that, also because it's a very repeat use case. So you have become our member and now you are using us again and again. And there is a communication cycle which is there, because you are requesting your salary from us, we are transferring that salary to you at the end of the month, you are settling that account with us, and then you are restarting that account, right? So there is this communication which actually keeps happening. So at any point in time when we feel that, so sometimes when customer has the need, they revert to us, and at the settling time we revert to them to remind them and all. So those are the kind of templates that we actually use with WhatsApp. For us, metrics that actually are important, but that turnaround time is one of the most important metric for us. And for us, turnaround time is from the moment a customer found us to the moment that we got him as a member. And after that, once he is a member, how much time we are taking to process his request, which nowadays is more real time. For the first one, that one is very important. Are we taking 24 hours? Are we taking 7 hours? Are we taking 3 hours? Are we taking 2 hours? And so on and so forth. We want it to be down to 30 minutes. Because in the beginning days, we were restricted by growth, by the channel itself. I think we were able to track them real time. But let me put it differently, like we made sure that we are delivering that and then the growth came. And now it's other way around, right? We open our pipes. There's a lot of people who are coming to us and we want to ensure that they are getting that experience. So on Verloop, we do see how much time we took, but I think right now the most important thing that we are tracking is that how many queries were resolved in total in the day. At the end of the day, we want every query to be resolved. I will answer that question in two parts, right? One, metrics that we get from WhatsApp, and the metrics that we get from Verloop, and we are still yet building a lot on it. But for example, one of the metrics is when our customers are active. And that goes back to real-time resolution. Most of our users are working, most like all of them are working, and that means during the day they do not have time to revert back, and also we don't want them to engage at that time. So what are the peak times when there is a chat support needed? What is the low times? And accordingly, having our team structured around it has been one of the big ones from Verloop. Second, I think Verloop also gives us that how many users are actually in the waiting, how many are not waiting, kind of a thing. So we can actually model our whole support system around that very, very easily. Some metrics that we get from WhatsApp which are super useful yet integrating and all of that is, and that's one of the asks which now Verloop is building the team on, that if we send a message, we want to real time know if the message was read, not read, all of that. And that actually plays a lot of role in our understanding of the user, behavioral analysis of the user, that when we send a message, what time do they respond back, what time they do not respond back. They have read our message or not, the number is active or not anymore, right? Things like that actually goes into our credit behavior analysis. And that, those are some of the metrics that we use. For me, WhatsApp is an integral part of the product. For us, it's not one of the channels. For it's not one of the lead generation channel or one of the support channel. For us, WhatsApp is lead gen, everything, right? So our business depends on it. And since our business depends on it and we know our customers require support, for us having Verloop is critical. So I would say that Verloop has helped, or WhatsApp has, Verloop through WhatsApp has helped us in growth, because I could not have more than 6 people doing this. Now I can have 20 people doing this. So I can actually absorb large number of people in this. That's how I'll say. Kaarva will always run on WhatsApp. When a user comes, there are 3 ways we will respond back to them. One, our system will respond back directly. So the query comes from Verloop to our backend and we revert back real time. Second is Verloop has recipes where we can actually automate some of the flows quite nicely. That is the second channel which will pick up more. The future for me there is that we will build that on as many languages as we can, so that we are able to do it faster. And the third one is what we are already using, which is the agent-powered module. So to me, as we grow, I see more of our agents growing, and through Verloop, we'll do some of this. We envision not only access to early pay, their earned wages, but also if a user wants a little longer term advance, to even if they want to save at source, to buying insurance, like all of these can be part of it. But basically what happens is that once a company is on board with us, a user can even get access to their payslip through us on WhatsApp, right? So that's how we envision that it becomes one channel. A user just responds from a menu of items. I want to do a cash advance. I want to do my earned salary. I want to save money. I want to see what is that I have earned. I want to see my whole pay salary, salary slip, right? All of that we can enable on WhatsApp. That's how we look at from a B2B integration perspective. So right now WhatsApp Pay is a UPI payment, right? So you don't need to go to any other UPI app, but if I want to make a payment to any of my contacts as well as to any UPI ID, I can do both of them. Paying to a contact is very, very easy. Why? Because it's whole of your WhatsApp contact list. So you can just select them if they are active on WhatsApp Pay. Like a UPI, like how do you activate on a UPI? You can just make a transaction. So right now WhatsApp is actually only peer-to-peer payments. They are yet to integrate, I believe, even payment of bills through Bharat Bill pay system. But I'm sure they will get there. Now, I will be really excited when businesses can accept payments on WhatsApp Pay, because then our whole vision of enabling this end-to-end on WhatsApp becomes a true reality. There are 4 aspects of the product that we have. One is getting the user onboarded. So user is giving some documents that we anyways do on WhatsApp. Communicating to the user that yes, you have been approved, you have become our member. The user requesting some amount that when we transfer, we anyways send a message back on WhatsApp, and we can do that to even their WhatsApp UPI, and then the user at the end of the cycle reverting back that amount to us. And that if that user is able to do that also on WhatsApp, which will be a reality if a user can not only do peer-to-peer but also pay an enterprise on that, then you can imagine we don't even have to go anywhere out but have this whole vision of end-to-end transaction of any financial product a reality on WhatsApp. Because you don't want to spam your users, right? And we of one, I think one big difference between sending notifications or SMS versus a WhatsApp is you have to be very cognizant that you are striking a conversation rather than a notification. So while WhatsApp templates are of the nature that they are notifications, but in reality the power of WhatsApp lies in communication, conversation. Conversation is only meaningful when you actually get the reward back within a few seconds. If you're not getting a reward back in a few seconds, it is as good as a notification.